President Andrikia Maha.
Hi everyone, good morning. As President Keish said, my name is Andrikia Maha, class of 2017. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I'm so honored that you all are here this morning. I have the pleasure of introducing Shaun King, and at this time, I'd like to read his bio for you. Shaun King is an award-winning entrepreneur and humanitarian, widely regarded as one of today's leading voices on how social media and a little bit of courage can make our world a radically better place. He speaks a message of hope and action over 150 times a year, has appeared in over 100 national and international press outlets, started and sold 3 tech companies, and raised over $10 million for causes all over the world. Currently a full-time writer for the Daily Kos, Shaun recently won the Mashable Award for the Most Creative Social Good Campaign. An executive coach for a rich variety of leaders, Shaun is married to his high school sweetheart, Ray. Their young family currently lives in New York City, but has called South Africa, Atlanta, Kentucky, and Manhattan home over the past few years. After Shaun's keynote, audience members will engage in a question and answer session through social media. Please use the hashtag It's Time for Justice, the number 4, to submit your questions. Please join me in welcoming to the podium, Shaun.
Thank you all. So good to be here with each of you. It's my honor and privilege. I see some friends and family here as well. Watching that video, I have so much to say and so little time to say it. First, before we really get started, I want to say a little bit about Agnes Scott. Particularly, if you weren't here when I spoke earlier this year, I wanted to just give my observation about how amazing Agnes Scott is. And for those of you, I'm 36, so for those of you who are my age or older, you probably knew a very different Agnes Scott. And I was student government president at Morehouse in 1999, and we partnered with every school in Atlanta, Agnes Scott, all the AUC schools, Emory and Georgia State. And even in 1999, the Agnes Scott that I knew was a white school. Like that's how, like we, when we thought of Agnes Scott, when we partnered with Agnes Scott was the school for white women that we partnered with. And so when I came here, I did not know Agnes Scott had changed. So when I came here earlier this year, it was like, where am I? Because I did not expect it to have changed so radically and in some of the deepest ways imaginable. And I've spoken over the past few years at colleges all over the country and around the world, and every school I go to is talking about change. And they're talking about the change that they want to see, but very few of them are actually doing it in the way that I see it being done here at Agnes Scott. And so I honor you, your president, Kajua, you are amazing, and all of the staff here, you're always so kind. You have a great student government president who is like a sister of the people. And I'm just glad to be here with all of you. We're gonna take some questions at the end, and I'm looking forward to that. But I wanna spend probably the next 30 to 40 minutes trying to give all of us some context. I'm gonna take this mic out and just stand here and walk around a little bit to give us some context for where we are right now, how we got here, and then what we can do about it. And I'm deeply encouraged. Like coming to Agnes Scott encourages me in part because I really feel like Agnes Scott is an example for the possibility of the changes that can happen. It's just a microcosm, a small example of the possibilities that can happen in our country. And in a lot of ways, Agnes Scott has tried to look and feel like the best of this country and is wrestling with so many of the important issues. I saw earlier this week the dean, I believe it was the dean of students at the University of Chicago, sent not just a welcome letter, or an unwelcome letter, in a sense, to the incoming students. I don't know the man, but it struck me as deeply insensitive. And in the letter, he had just one sentence that conservatives and even literally white supremacists and people all over the world were just so excited about, where he said, "Hey, on this campus," it's a weird thing to say, "we will not have safe spaces." It's a weird thing to say, and we will not do trigger warnings. And it's just like that's exactly like he literally said those words, and people all around the country just like exploded with glee. They were just like so, and it was a bit out of the norm for the University of Chicago in a way, and it surprised me, and I think it kind of revealed an aloofness to their dean on why some spaces need to be particularly safe for particular people. And, you know, Agnes Scott, where I went to school at Morehouse, where my wife went to school at Spelman, those schools in particular were created actually to be safe spaces. Like, they were created with a very particular person in mind, designed in essence to be a refuge from a lot of the pressures of the world. And for those of you who are, if you're an Agnes Scott student, raise your hand so I know who I'm talking to. Like, good. And for those of you that are here, you know, when you're here on campus, to a degree that you are able to kind of let your guard down, right? And it was that way when I entered Morehouse in 1997, and for the 4 years that I was at 830 Westview Drive, I knew I could let my guard down. Like, I knew nobody was gonna say, there were gonna be no racists on campus. Like, I knew that there was a reasonable degree of protection. And this doesn't have anything to do with where I'm going, but I want to acknowledge the importance of creating spaces like what we're in right now, conversations, retreats, but also institutions that allow people to grow and lead. Like, I was student government president at Morehouse, but where I came from in rural Kentucky, I could never be a student leader. Like, had I gone to the University of Kentucky, you probably would not know me today. But at Morehouse, I could shine and grow, in part because that space was created for a guy like me. And so it's important that we continue to create spaces, conversations, and dialogues, and retreats. And I want to echo, Kajua, what you said, that something special can come out of what we do here today. I say this a lot. It's really hard to understand a historical moment when you're in it. Like, if you go back and look at the Montgomery bus boycott in 1954, 1955, with Rosa Parks and Dr. King, they did not even have the phrase back then, civil rights movement. That phrase had not even really been coined yet. They were just men and women who were tired of being mistreated. Like, at that point at least, Dr. King, who had only graduated Morehouse a few years before that, he was actually kind of still finishing his PhD and his dissertation when he was pastoring this church in Montgomery. He was a very young man. I don't even think they fully understood where they were in that moment in history. And I'll say it like this, particularly, it's a kind of a religious joke, and those are, you're not even supposed to tell religious jokes. But, you know, like, I tell people all the time, Jesus's last name was not Christ, right? It wasn't like first name Jesus, last name Christ. That's not, that was something that we have been, like, I don't even fully know if he had a last name. but it was definitely was not Christ. I said it to say that history imposes things on you that, like, he as a historical figure, Jesus, was really not even that respected. At least the religious story goes that when he died on the cross, even his friends weren't there. He was not popular. And history has changed how we look back on certain people and certain movements. And it's hard to understand how important a moment, how important a person, how important a time or event. It's hard to understand how important that thing is when you're in it. I said that to say that I really believe that we are in a moment. And it has felt for a couple of years now, for any of you, hey, what's up, man? I didn't see, this is my friend Adam, good to see you. We haven't seen each other in a couple of years, so good to see you. I see a lot of my friends here. That the past few years have felt different. Like, I want to say it just like that, because it's even hard for me to fully put words on it, but 2014, 2015, 2016 have felt, just talking about how they feel in my heart, in my mind, in my soul, they have felt very different. I think they have felt different because they are different. I'm pushing this narrative a lot in my writing, and I believe it. I believe that racism and bigotry and the brutality that come along with those things are actually getting much worse. And I say that from, like, a perspective of statistical analysis, that I hear a really well-intentioned lie being told over and over and over again. And even I've been on several panels over the past few months where really good people have repeated this, but it's not based in any fact or truth. I keep hearing people say police brutality or bigotry or racism, they are not getting worse. Social media and other things are just telling the story more. And I understand why they think that. Because indeed, social media is allowing us to tell more stories. But I've been studying this almost nonstop for the past 2 years, and the world can get better and can get worse. Like, there are moments in time where society and the quality of society worsens in tragic ways. The Holocaust was a worsening of the quality of humanity. For those Jewish families, it wasn't, hey, it's just the news telling those stories more. That's not the reality. It got worse. It got a lot worse. For Africans, the transatlantic slave trade was worse than the period of time before that existed. There is this notion that no, things are not getting worse, it's just we have Twitter now. And I think implicit in that conclusion is a really sincere struggle to accept that we are in a time where the world is getting worse. Like, I think there's a reluctance to accept it because it sucks. I guess, like, it is a terrible thing to be living in the time where a lot of things are getting worse. And I want to push this for a second, and then I'm gonna pivot and give us some hardcore solutions and thoughts. And some, I think, will be very conventional, and some will really push your thinking. There are two books that I would love for you to read, and I don't suggest a lot of books, but because I'm going to pick up where those two books leave off. There's a book called Slavery by Another Name, and it won the Pulitzer Prize. It's a powerful book, and Douglas Blackman, I think, is the author. And if you Google that, PBS did a documentary, and you can view that whole documentary for free online. I think it's even on YouTube, but if you Google Slavery by Another Name,
And what Douglas Blackman actually lived in Atlanta and was a very conservative man who wrote for the Wall Street Journal. And he started hearing these stories while he was living here in Atlanta. He was the Atlanta bureau chief for the Wall Street Journal of people, primarily black men and women, after the official abolition of slavery, who were forced to work for free, sometimes until death, after 1865. Like, slavery as we know it ended in 1865, and he started studying it, and the entire book is about this period from 1865 to 1950, where slavery existed in America, not for hundreds or thousands, but tens of thousands, and he pushes it, maybe up to 1 million people were forced into slavery by another name. And he exposed this idea, and it's not a conspiracy theory, that when slavery was abolished, there's an asterisk next to that that says it is abolished except if you are in prison. It says that, like, you should go and read it. There is a phrase right there that says slavery is done unless, and that kind of went over the heads of people. And what he realized is that there were entire, I couldn't believe it when I saw it, because even my major at Morehouse was African American Studies, and we didn't even talk about this. But there were entire corporations after 1865, after the abolition of slavery, that were built on free labor of people who were arrested and incarcerated just for the purpose of growing those businesses. Like, these were not true criminals. People were being arrested so that they could be free labor. And he tells this in his book. Then the other book is The New Jim Crow. And what's powerful about those two books together is that Michelle Alexander begins where he leaves off. He ends in 1950, and she kind of picks the baton up and says, let me explain to you what happened from 1950 until 2010. And in The New Jim Crow, she explains, here's what happened in the civil rights movement. And then what's most important about her book is that she says, after the official end of segregation in America as we know it, after the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act passed, there was something really interesting that happened. And I'm gonna explain that, and then I'm gonna start where she left off, and then I'm gonna work in terms of, because she doesn't give a lot of solutions in her text. And she gives a blueprint for us on why the problem exists. But, and you may have heard me say this before, but I say it a lot, if I could squeeze The New Jim Crow down to two or three sentences, what Michelle Alexander is saying is that the United States as we know it today is not broken. What she's saying is, stop saying the system is broken. She said, it is functioning the way it was designed to function. It was built this way on purpose. That nothing about American society, about systems of incarceration, about systems of discrimination, that nothing we saw on that video is accidental, but is all a very painful reflection of the system that people built and designed on purpose. Now, there might be unintended consequences of the system that people built, but in The New Jim Crow, she is explaining how people deliberately designed the systems that we are now living in. That's important because there is this notion that it's a good system that needs a few little tweaks. And what The New Jim Crow is saying is no. It is a highly complicated, terrible system that took decades and decades to build, And the inference in her text is that it will be extremely difficult to undo it. I think of our system sometimes like a cake. And a cake has flour and eggs and sugar and milk and maybe some type, it may be chocolate or flavor and icing. Like our current system, to make a tweak would be like trying to take the cooked eggs out of the cake and then put them back into the shell and have a perfect egg again. Like once you bake the cake, you can no longer extract the egg. It becomes something totally different. That our system doesn't just need like a few small tweaks and extractions. The system itself is corrupt and kind of rotten at its core, and it has done so on the backs of the people that we saw in this video. That the deadliest hate crime in the past almost 100 years is what happened at the Pulse nightclub this year. So from the beginning of the civil rights movement until yesterday, until today, there's never been a deadlier hate crime targeting a particular group of people than what we saw at the Pulse nightclub. The deadliest hate crime against African Americans did not take place in the past 75 years, did not take place in 1950 or 60 or 1970 or 80. It took place last year in Charleston, South Carolina at Emmanuel AME. Some things are getting worse. That in 1970, there were less than 200,000 people incarcerated in America. Today, there are at least 2.2 million. That is evidence. That's not social media. So I'm trying to explain. What happened at the Pulse nightclub, what happened at Emmanuel AME, didn't happen because Twitter now exposes the evils of the world. No, it happened because things are getting worse. That the worst year ever measured for police brutality in America was 2015. 1,207 people were killed by American police last year, and that's the worst of any year ever measured or known. So, yes, social media is detailing that. What social media is doing is it is indeed showing us the problems, but it's showing us that the problems are getting worse. And when I spoke here last, Donald Trump was not yet the nominee, and I didn't even know how much I should speak about it. But we're talking about a man who any reasonable person would tell you is bigoted, and he's not just crass, he's not just politically incorrect, but he's dangerous. That he's sexist, that he's offensive, that he has threatened to, in 18 months, deport forcefully 11 million people who are undocumented in this country. That's over 450,000 people a month. It could very, if something like that happened, it could very well create a war in this country. Forcefully deporting 450,000 people a month looks like the Holocaust. Like, where are they going to go? Who is going to take them? What methods are you going to put them in? Cars, trucks, and trains? Planes? Like how? Where? When? Who? What if people say they don't want to go? How will you get them? It's a crazy idea that actually helped him get this. I'm talking about it getting worse. He received more votes than any Republican nominee in the history of this country. More than Romney, more than George W. Bush. He received more votes for the Republican nomination than Ronald Reagan or Richard Nixon. He's not unpopular. This morning, LA Times has a poll with him in the lead nationally. So social media plays a role in that, but it is a deep reflection of where we are as a country. That he just hired as his campaign CEO a terrible bigot, a well-known white supremacist. And people, like reasonable people, like I wouldn't even put myself in that classification. When I say reasonable people, I'm talking about people other than myself. I'm talking about like moderates, like calm, cool, moderate people. Even scratched their head when he hired this man, Stephen Bannon, to become the new CEO of his campaign. It came out just late last night, the horrendous things that Stephen Bannon has said about Jews. That he literally told his wife, quote, "I hate Jews." And his wife testified under oath in a deposition that he did not want his kids going to a school that had a high population of Jewish students. And he explained he basically did not want them to rub off on his children. He was arrested for domestic violence. And just in the past 24 hours, we've found at least 4 or 5 instances where he threatened other women that he worked with physical violence. Just crazy. He is the CEO of Donald Trump's campaign. And he is unlikely to be fired for any of that. It is a symptom. When we look at these, when we look at videos of the civil rights movement, there is a tendency to look at them and say, wow, things were really bad. I'm a historian by training. I promise you that 30 and 40 years from now, when our kids look at videos from 2016, they're gonna be like, whoa, what a mess. It's crazy. And it probably feels that way to you and looks that way to you. And almost every one of us in the room has, at one time or another over the past year, felt very insecure about our place in this world. It's a terrible thing. And it does not have to be this way. I want to pivot and talk some about our solutions, but I wanted to argue for a moment the fact that things are as bad as they feel like in your heart. That your mind, listen, trust your instinct. There's a book by Malcolm Gladwell called Blink. And in the book, he actually says that your instinct or your gut is actually a very complicated thing. It's not. Your instinct took however old you are, 18, 20, 30, 40, 50, however old you are, it took that long to build your gut, your heart, your instinct. And what I do not want you to do is to try to force on your heart or your instinct or your gut, maybe it's not as bad as it feels. What that is your mind trying to protect itself from the ugliness that we are seeing in the world. But I want to impress on you, it is as ugly as your heart feels like it is. It is as different as that. Now, I feel, and I've even come under attack for saying this, but I believe it in my heart, my gut, my instinct, that we are at a very peculiar place where I am extremely concerned that a few more awful incidents could push this country to a really, really weird place. I would even say that we are already in that place. I'm going to be very sensitive about this, but the shootings of police officers in Dallas and Baton Rouge, and also there was an incident in Baltimore with a young lady named Corinne Gaines, I think are a reflection. I hate what happened to the police officers in Dallas and Baton Rouge, and I hate violence, and I wish that we lived in a peaceful place without it. But the two black men who led those shootings of police officers in Dallas and Baton Rouge were educated and trained, and the young man in Baton Rouge was actually an award-winning soldier. Both of them were veterans. And both of them, I actually don't believe that, I kind of agree. I thought there was this powerful moment in the video where they're talking to Dr. Drew about the about what happened in Charleston. And she's saying, hey, let's stop talking about what Dylann Roof did in Charleston as being a mental health crisis, that it was racism. Yeah. I want to use that same logic. Like, I don't believe the young men who did what they did in Baton Rouge and Dallas, like, there are some thoughts that there that those guys were under stress. And I think they did exactly what they wanted to do. I think, and I wrote pieces saying this, I think that what they did was terribly American. That it was a deep, ugly, painful reflection of who and what America is. That it was violent. Those guys were legal, trained gun owners. And both of them said that they did what they did because they were frustrated with police brutality. In Baltimore County, a young woman, I'm so grieved by her story, Corinne Gaines, a young mother with two young kids. She was arrested in March because the tags on her license plate were not, she owned the car legally. Her family is a part of this peculiar group that wants to live off the grid. Like, they don't want to register. They are understandably deeply skeptical of the government. And so her family had this, they're part of this group that says, we're not doing license plates. We're not doing IDs. We're not doing social security numbers for our newly born children. We're not doing vaccines. They're a part of that group. She bought a car legally. Someone saw that she did not have the license plate on. She had her youngest child was newly born in the back. She had a 4 or 5 year old son in the back. Police pulled her over and they wanted to arrest her, but she had her kids in the car. She refused to get out of the car, and she ended up getting very violently arrested in front of her kids, in front of her newborn. It was a very traumatizing thing. Her family has said that she was actually pregnant at the time, had a miscarriage because of the arrest. And over the next few months, from none of us knew this, over the next few months, she proceeded to have a really contentious back and forth with the court system and the police department. And thankfully, she filmed all of this. She literally YouTubed it and Facebooked it and Instagrammed it for months. She could not get the right paperwork about her arrest.